Hi everyone, welcome. My name is Chloe Jury Fogel. I'm on the video team at Jazz at Lincoln Center. I hope everyone's doing okay. It's very rainy and gloomy here in New York City, wherever you are, has a little more sun. In just a minute, we're gonna join Jazz at Lincoln Center Orchestra trumpeter Marcus Printup for a live masterclass on form. After the lesson, Marcus will answer some questions from you all. At that time, I'll jump back in and explain how to ask him a question. For now, I'm going to turn it over to Marcus. I hope you enjoy it.
All right. Thanks a lot. How's it going out there in this virtual world? Very happy to be here with you. Broadcasting live from my man cave in New Jersey. We're going to talk today about form, and I'm not going to speak much up front. I'll speak later. My wife and I made this video a few weeks ago that's going to basically explain everything that we need to hear. So let's have fun. Here's the video. Enjoy it.
All right. Hello again. Marcus Printup back with you. We're going to now talk about different ways to hear music or to listen to music. You know, it's very easy to just hear a song and go, oh man, sounds good. That sounds great. Sounds really good. But to really go in depth and to really listen to the music, I'm gonna give you some things just to think about in this lesson. I want you to challenge yourself to listen to forms and to themes as well. There's a song by the great Duke Ellington called Satin Doll. Now the song itself is in an AABA form. To all you jazz musicians and some classical musicians, y'all know what that is, but to those who don't, I'm gonna explain. So each section of an AAB form gets 8 bars. 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 2, 3, 4, 3, 2, 3, 4, 4, 2, 3, 4, 5, 2, 3, 4, 6, 2, 3, 4, 7, 2, 3, 4, 8, 2, 3, 4. That's one, that's the first A section. Now the second A section, because it's AABA, is pretty much the same thing as the first A. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 2, 3, 4, 3, 2, 3, 4, 4, 2, 3, 4, 5, 2, 3, 4, 6, 2, 3, 4, 7, 2, 3, 4, 8, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 2, 3, 4, 3, 2, 4, 2, 3, 4, 5, 2, 3, 4, 6, 2, 3, 4, 7, 2, 3, 4, 8, 2, 3, 4. That's AA. Now the B is the next section, and some people call that the bridge because that's the bridge in between the A section and the final, the first two A sections, AA, then the bridge, which is B, and then there's a final A section, A. So AA, BA. So all the A sections are the same pretty much. I'm just going to play the melody of Satin Doll for you, and you'll hear that in the musical context. Here we go. Say that with me. Say AABA. Here we go.
AABA.
And each A section, each section has how many bars in it?
Eight.
And what is another word for the B section? Bridge. So AABA. That's what this form is. Now let's get back to Duke Ellington. And I'm going to play this entire track of Duke's orchestra playing Satin Doll. And then I'm going to, the whole track is just like 3 minutes. And then I'm going to break down each section by section and explain to you what Duke and his orchestra did to make this recording so sophisticated. So this is Duke Ellington's orchestra playing Satin Doll. Here we go. ¶¶ Duke Ellington Orchestra. Fabulous. Doesn't get any better than that. Yeah. All right. Whew. It's just gratifying just to hear it. But, you know, we're being intellectual and we're still feeling at the same time. So I'm going to break down a lot of things about this arrangement that they did. So let's go back to the beginning. Remember, we talked about AABA form. The first thing Duke Ellington does to deviate away from the traditional AABA form is he plays a four-bar introduction. And the four-bar introduction is just piano, and the bass kind of sneaks in. So they play this four bars, and maybe some of you are non-musicians, four bars is one, two, three, four. That's a bar. One, two, three, four. Two, two, three, four. Three, two, three, four. Four, two, three, four. Those are four bars. Count with me at home. Ready? And one, two, three, four. Two, two, three, four. Three, two, three, four. Four, two, three, four. Boom. And right, boom is when the actual AABA comes in. So Duke plays a four-bar piano intro with the bass. Here we go. And right there is where the melody comes in. So that's the first deviation that he did from the actual AABA form. A piano introduction with the bass. Now, the first A section. Let me get this set up so where I can just loop it over and over. Let's see. Here we go. Here's the first A. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Now, what we hear now is the saxophone section is playing the melody, but they're playing in a very unique form. Usually, well, in sax sections, there's the lead alto, the second alto, the first tenor, the second tenor, and the baritone sax is the lowest and deepest voice. But in Duke's band, he has the great baritone saxophonist Harry Carney playing the melody. And the first and second altos and first and second tenors are playing harmony to Harry's melody. Check this out. Do that. No, no, that's very sax. That's the first thing I noticed. Now the second thing, if I think about the rhythm section is playing in a two feel versus a four feel. This is in duple meter, meaning it's in something that's divisible by two. So a two feel is a one, a two, a one, a two, step up to one, a two, a one. Versus a four feel, which would be a one, two, three, four, one, two, three, ba ba ba, one, two. So this is a two feel. A one, do this with me. Go a one, a two, a one, a two, ba ba da, one, a two, a one, two. That's a two feel. Now check out the rhythm section doing that. Here we go. Drums are just swinging along. The piano is, Duke Ellington is filling in, comping behind the melody and the two fill. Now, what we notice also is the trombone section is playing a unison whole note as a background to the sax melody. Check this out. The saxes are going, ba-ba-da-da-da, ba-ba-ba, and the trombones are going, check it out. Oh, what's cool about that, Duke is a genius. Duke had the saxophone section playing the melody while the trombones played long notes, but then when the saxophones played a whole note at the end, be-da, behold, then the trombones played a counter line. Check this out. Icing on the cake, the mighty trumpet section comes in with a forzano crescendo, the last measure, which leads back into the A section again. Yeah, it's so dramatic. So what I'll do is play the first A section in its entirety, and then I'll go to the second A section, which is for the first six bars. Remember bars, 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 2, 3, 4. For the first six bars, it's the exact same, but instead of the accented whole note that the trumpet section plays, Paul Gonzalez, the great tenor saxophone player, is going to play a smooth line in transition to go to the B section, which is the bridge. All right, so I'll play from the first A section. I'll play from the top, and I'll stop before the bridge. Here we go. Session goes into four to the four feel. So instead of boom, a doom, a one, two, they go to four. A 1, 2, 3, 4, a 1, 2, 3, and they're swinging. That's the first thing that you should listen for. The second thing you should listen for is the saxophone section continue to play the melody, but instead of them being in harmony with Harry Carney playing the lead line on the baritone saxophone, they're in unison. And they're all in the same register. They're beep, alto's there, the tenors are there, and the baritone is there too. So the first two things to listen to is the rhythm section playing in four, a 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, and the sax section playing together in unison. And also check out the trombone section as well. The trombone section is also playing backgrounds, but now they're in harmony. Here we go. So now the saxophone section is in unison and the bones are harmonizing. I'll stop there. So again, let's check that out again. The trombones and the bass. The trombone section and the bass section harmonizing that that stretch chord progression going into the fifth bar. Do 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 da bo da ba da ba do da ba do da da ba do da ba do da harmony. Okay, now let's listen again to the bridge. Your first thing again to check out is the drums and bass playing in a four feel. Let's hear that first. Let's listen to the same four bars. Listen for the saxophone section playing in unison. Okay, now this time we're going to listen to the trombone section playing in harmony. And let's see, The band plays an abrupt break at the on the anna 4 going to the third bar. I'll show you the anna 4 going to the third bar, where everybody lays out. They stop playing except for the trombone section and the bass section and the bassist. And they're still in harmony, and they're stretching the chord progression by chromatically ascending up and down a minor third. Do 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 dee do do da. So let's hear all that. Okay, there we go. Now there's four more bars left in the bridge. The last four bars after a bass fill on the anna 4. When I say the anna 4, I mean 1, 2, 3, 4. Ah, that's the anna 4. 1, 2, 3. Oh, ah. So on the anna 4, the mighty trumpet sections play. The mighty trumpet section plays a melody led by the lead trumpeter, Cat Anderson, soaring above the band in the high octave, while the sax sections and the sax section and the trombones join each other for background hits and playing the same chord progression stretching line that the bones played earlier. Do 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 dee do do da. Check it out. Trumpets. Duke Ellington. All right. I get excited talking about Duke Ellington. Now the last A section, because we're doing AABA, that was just the B section. Now the last A, after another bass lead-in, the rhythm section goes back to that two fill. A boom, a boom, a boom. Then the saxes play the melody again in harmony with the baritone sax playing the lead line. Then the trumpets play closed and open plunger mutes. This is a plunger mute again. And closed mute is all the way in. So they go. And tune in later this week, because I'm going to give an overview of how to use a plunger mute. There's a lot of lessons we have planned, my wife and I, but I'm just kind of skating through it now because we're talking about the music. So that's going to happen, and that happens in the trumpet section, and then the trombones answer that. Ooh, ah, with a long note. Ah. Ooh, ah. Ah. Ooh, ah. Ah. Then the trumpets go. Ah. Ooh, 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 ah. Check it out. 8ABA. Now what do they do next? They have, I gave my wife some pictures to post this, one of my favorite trumpet players, his name is Ray Nance. Ray Nance did everything with Duke Ellington. If they were to give an MVP award to a player of Duke's band, I think it would be Ray Nance. Ray Nance played the trumpet, he played the violin, he could really sing, and he also danced. The great Ray Nance. I gotta give Ray some props, man. I love Ray Nance. So, what happens now, this is called the solo section because he's playing, but they go back to the bridge, and they feature Ray Nance, and he's playing an improvised solo off of the melody. So the melody is. But Ray is kind of playing something improvised, but based off of that melody, like. You know? which is also a lesson in life. I like to follow rules because rules are really important, but I like to take things and make them my own as well. And you should do the same thing. That's what Ray Nance did with this melody. So let's just listen to him playing instead of me talking about it. Let's go back here. One. Ray Nance. Say his name on the count of three. Ray Nance. One, two, three.
Ray Nance.
And if you notice, the rhythm section goes back to the four feel. A one, two, a three, a four, a boom, 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 boom. Check it out. Saxophone backgrounds. There we go. That's the bridge. So for now we have the piano intro, bass intro, A, B, A. And now we go back to the B section, to the bridge, where there's a trumpet solo. Ray Nance is playing a trumpet solo. Now what's going to happen after that? They go back to the final A section, which features a trumpet screaming in octaves, meaning that the second, third, and fourth trumpets are going, but the lead trumpet is playing an octave above him. Alright, that's what's happening. And while the trombones and the saxes play a counter melody, which is, it's like a second melody that bounces against with the main melody. And notice the drummer, Sam Woodyard, he's playing accented kicks to uplift the band, and everything kind of fits like a puzzle. You have the drums playing those kicks, you have the bass swinging, you have the piano copying, you have the trumpet section playing the melody, you have the saxes and the saxophone section and the trombone section playing a counter line. And this one is what it sounds like together. Here's Ray again. Bridge. Next, there's still time left. There's still like 40 seconds left. They go back to the A section and play the A section one final time. The saxes are still playing the melody, but now the baritone sax is not playing the lead line. Lead alto saxophonist Johnny Hodges is playing the lead line. So the berry is back on the bottom. Again, it's just like a course. They say SATB, soprano, alto, tenor, bass. The sax section and most sections are kind of voiced that way. The lead alto is like, then the second is a little lower, then the first tenor, second tenor, then the berry, is lower. That's how you voice, that's a standard voicing for a sax section. Now, there's also different harmonies in the melody as well. And that's another whole class of how to analyze harmony, which we'll get to. And there's no trombone background until the sixth bar of this. And when they finish this last A section, we're gonna end as we started with a four bar outro, not an intro, but an outro that's the same as it was in the beginning, but it resolves with the bass player playing boom, the root. So here we go. slide is on lead, no background at all. And the bones are coming in right here. Now the outro, the last four bars. Gentlemen, the incomparable Duke Ellington. Thank you.
So I'm going to turn over to Marcus to finish his lesson. I'll unmute. There you go.
Unmute. Awesome. Thank you. Well, thanks for listening, everyone. And just so you know, I am not a techie at all. I see people writing in. I see my brother Kenny Rampton writing in. I'm afraid to press a button because I'm afraid I'm going to disconnect everything. So hello, everyone who said hello. All right. So hopefully you learn and or maybe enhance just how you listen to music. There's just so much more to listening to music than just enjoying it. And that's a very important part too. But when you break down the music and you really know what's happening and you can enable yourself to hear different things every time you hear a song. I mean, I can listen to Miles Davis's Kind of Blue, my favorite jazz record of all time. And I've heard that record, you know, since I was, man, I think maybe like 18, no, maybe 19 years old. And I'm 53 now. Yeah, I'm pretty old. So I'm 53 now, but I still hear something every time that I've not heard before. So just always think about that when you're listening to music. Now, as Chloe said, this is informal. I have like a few more pieces of music just for us to listen to and analyze. But Chloe, do you think it's best if we just open the floor just for a break of listening to do some Q&A now, and then maybe if there's time to do the exercises I had planned next, or it's your call?
Whatever you think. We still have like 40 minutes, so whatever you think.
Oh, perfect. Okay. Well, you know what? Okay. Let's stay on path. I want to play another arrangement, composition arrangement of Duke. Well, actually, composition by Billy Strayhorn, and but performed by the Duke Ellington Orchestra. This is "Take the A Train." I found two versions of this, and I want you to listen to. How should I do this? Should I do them both right away? Yeah, you know what? Let's listen to them back to back, and I want you on at home to get your notepad or your iPad or whatever you write on these days, your typewriters, remember those? And just write down what you're hearing. And I wanna have your input and we can just compare what we're hearing. So the first version of A-Train, I think was recorded in 1963. It's a live concert. And it's basically, you know, just like the standard version of A-Train that you hear us play in the jazz at Lincoln Center Orchestra or any other orchestra. And the second version is a little different. So get your notepads out and write down what you're hearing, and let's do it. Here we go. Take the A Train.
All right. Thank you.
Big requests, Satin Doll.
Not today, Satin Doll. Next time. We just heard that. Ellington. Let's have a round of applause for Duke Ellington. Woo! And his fabulous orchestra. Let's see. And someone said, was that Sam Woodyard? I'm pretty sure that was Sonny Greer on the drums on the second take. I think it was Sam Woodyard on the first take. So, all right. Can everyone hear me? Yeah, I'm not.
Yeah, we can hear you.
I guess you can hear me. All right, so let's kind of break this down. We don't want to spend a lot of time on it, but we can spend as much time as we want to here. So can someone tell me what they heard in this arrangement?
If you want to answer Marcus' question now, you can use the raise hand function. Click on the participants tab on the bottom of your screen, and then participants tab, press the raise hand button. Maybe that's a good way to do this. What do you think? Type into the chat.
Okay, that's fine too. I can answer.
It seems like Jill raised her hand. Jill, do you want to?
Okay, great, stab? Great, Jill.
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Oh my gosh! Hi, everybody. Well, I feel very lucky because I'm this is really my mom Carol's class. But I'm.
Oh hey, Jill. That's Jill Sears.
Hey, okay. Marcus. Hey, Jill. How are you?
How's it going? Good to see you.
It's good to see you.
We'll get to hear you.
So I just stepped in. I came out of a work meeting and into yours. But from the little that I saw, it seemed like it was swing music. Am I wrong? Mm-hmm.
Yes, Duke Ellington's Take the A Train. Both of them were. So what I did is, in the very beginning of the class, we're talking about form, and for these two selections back to back, I just played videos of Duke Ellington's Take the same song, but different recordings. And
okay.
I asked the audience just to point out, the differences between the two selections.
Okay, so that's not. I'm not at that point yet, but thank you for having me.
No problem.
Thank you, Jill. All right, so it seems like we have some people in the comments that are answering. Someone says the horns had a faster beat. Someone said the form was different, no modulation in the second take.
Yeah, that's not true. There was a modulation in the second take. They both modulations are the same. They go from C to E flat. And when the vocalist comes in, I think someone wrote her name. I don't know her name. I think someone wrote her name up here earlier, and I should know that, but I don't.
Seton says her name is Betty Roche.
Thank you, Seton. The great Seton Hawkins. That's Betty Roche, R-O-C-H-E, if I'm not mistaken. So when she comes in, they modulate to E flat, and the tune starts out in C, and the same thing happens in the first arrangement as well. And to the person that said there's a faster beat, I think the first arrangement was a bit faster, but the second arrangement was a bit more laid back. Did anyone, any other hands raised before we go on? Because I have a lot to say, and then we'll all the things that we're talking about, what we may do is just listen to these again and write all the notes down that we're saying now. And when we listen to it again, you may hear something that you didn't hear in the first time, all right? And someone just typed in, of course, the train effects are in the second one. I mean, Duke Ellington loved trains. This is Take the A Train. And if you didn't see all the cats in their tuxedos dressed up behind that train, you may think it's an actual train because he was a master at incorporating or using his horns or his band, not just the horns, the drums are playing something, the bass is doing something too, and piano, of making them sound like something that's not music, but in everything is music to me. I mean, even if I do that, there's some harmony in that. There's music in these paintings I have behind me. There's music everywhere, and that's what Duke was able to emulate. So that's something that's different, of course, from the first take to the second take. Any other hands raised?
No, Jill's hand is raised again, but I don't know if that's a mistake. Is that a mistake, Jill, or did you want to say something?
No, it's definitely a mistake.
Okay. I'm going to lower her hand. Anyone else have anything to comment?
Go ahead.
I was going to say, if you wanted to open it up for more questions, we can also do that.
Okay. What I want to do is ask them, in the first take or the first one that we saw, did anyone notice anything about the soloist? Or did anyone notice anything about the form of that one? Or did we talk about AABA? Did anyone notice anything about the form? If you did, can you chime in and raise your hand and talk to us?
Don't be shy.
I think Gwen that said yes. So can you elaborate, Gwen?
I'll just call on you, Gwen. There you go.
Hello.
Hey, Gwen.
Kemp is here, the wonderful pianist who co-wrote the hit tune Bubbling Brown Sugar.
Wonderful. So
actually making comments in the background. And what was the difference, Emmy?
I want to say just first, I thank you guys for being there. And I thank that what you're doing.
She's speaking. Can you guys hear her?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. I think it's wonderful what you're doing, breaking down the orchestral part of it. Because, for example,
thank you.
One reason being, if you think you are a solo performer, as I've been many times in my life, if you have ignored the importance of taking those advanced orchestration or making arrangement training, keyboard harmony, or I want 22nd century music theory. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Take that, but if they called it piano harmony, keyboard harmony, or they could call it as we do, music theory, which I mm-hmm. did one summer, in summer of 65, when I moved 65 to New York from the West Coast. But I want to say that in 1964, when I was in New York for the first time, going to the fair, and I wanted to hear Count Basie and Duke Ellington and meet him. I didn't meet Count
Basie,
but I met Duke. And I went to Toronto for a videotaping. The singer then was Joya Cheryl. So it's not mm-hmm. really likely that we're going to always hear the same names depending on the year when something was done. 63, I think they said, was that first maybe recording possibly of, was it Satin Doll that we heard first?
Satin Doll, yes.
There was no singing on Satin Doll, right?
No.
Okay. Yeah, no, there wasn't.
He came along in A-Train. It was automatic that people thought that it would have been Ivy Anderson.
Yeah, I thought it was Ivy Anderson.
But it may have been on record another singer. I don't know, but because I think Joya Cheryl, didn't she contribute some of the lyrics to A-Train?
I'm not really sure, but if you say so, you sound like you're really smart, and I believe you.
I went to Toronto to catch a television taping.
But get to the...
on Toronto's television.
Right, but get to the breakdown.
And Joya Cheryl, that was singing at that time. I wanted to tell you that. And Sam,
oh, that's wonderful. Thank you.
At television performance.
All right. Thank you, Izzy. Marcus, we better come back to her.
You know what's funny? Maybe at some point we can have her talking and then do a talk. No, she's awesome. I love it. Maybe at some point we can have her tell her story because she seems to know a lot, and I love it. But we did have another question. And again, thank you for your comments. Thank you so much. And we will hear from you again.
Everyone, if you go down to your participants tab on the bottom of your Zoom window, and then in the tab, press the raise hand button. That makes it easier for us to call on you if you have a question.
I think someone said they had a question.
Yeah, so AD2. No,
82? Are you there,
is that
82?
You? Are you there? Go ahead. AD2, can you hear us? All right, AD2? We should stick to the. All right.
Can you type in your question, 82? Is it possible for you to type your question in? And while you're typing in your question, I do want to say, let's see. Okay, I was wondering about
modulation.
You mean, do you want a definition of modulation? Is that what you're saying? Is that what you're saying, 82? And the measure is the passages. All right, so basically what they do, they play the melody one time, and let's just take the second take. After the AABA form, there's like a drum break, and then there's an interlude, and the interlude is what kind of establishes the first AABA from the next section. So the horns are like, bop, and now we're in a different key. So we started out in in this key. We started out right here. Let me get my mute in so I don't blast your ears out. We started out like this. Then the trumpets come in. Then different key. So we modulated from to this. And what made that modulation possible was that interlude. Okay, I'm gonna play, if I had my piano here, I'd play the piano with the left hand and this with the right, but it's downstairs. So anyway, so I'll play the last A section of the melody on trumpet, and then I'll play the interlude, and then I'll go into that different, into the next key so you can hear it clearly. Here we go. Drum interlude, then the trumpets come. That's the interlude, and that's how you know it's a different key. All right. Someone said that was a mistake.
Okay. Before we take some more questions, I just have a couple things I want to say. And for those of you that are just joining us, this is a masterclass by Marcus Printup from the Lincoln Center Orchestra. Marcus has been exploring form in jazz by breaking down Duke Ellington classics. Satin Doll, and he's now going to take some questions from you guys for real. Before we get started, I just want to take a moment to give a huge thanks to all of our supporters who help us serve the global jazz community. We wouldn't be here without you. Your support means so much to so many. So again, if anyone has a question they'd like to ask Marcus, please use the raise hand feature. I'd like to avoid using the comment section for questions. Again, to do this, click participants on the bottom of your Zoom window, and then in your participants tab, press the raise hand button. Please make sure that your full name appears as your username as well, so I can call on you. It avoids calling you by any weird username. When it's your turn to speak, I'll call your name and then I'll unmute you so that we can hear you. So let's go.
I have a question. Chloe, so I thought that you were supposed to be practicing social distancing. There's like a group of people behind you in an audience.
I know. I don't get it. I came to I missed the Appel room so much. I came.
Oh, sorry about that. Okay.
All right. Let's go to Finn Gomez. Go ahead, Finn.
Hey, Marcus.
Hey, Zen. How you doing?
Good. How are you? Do you remember me? We met in Detroit.
Yeah, I remember you, man. Good to see you.
Hey,
again.
How's it going? Good. Right. I'm keeping busy. All right. So my question for you was, I'm working on Weatherbird, you know. How do work on one thing? You go from, you're looking at the form, you listen to all the different changes. How do you just know what to go to next? So, you know, you get one thing down, but then you realize you missed 30 other things. You know what I'm saying?
That's like life itself. You know, you just keep on doing it. And like I said, there are things that I find every day that, you know, and things that I've been doing for years. For instance, Weatherbird Rag is a solo that I gave Finn to learn. Was it January or February? I can't remember when that was.
I think it was the end of January. It was your birthday.
Yeah. Oh, that's the 24th. I turned 22. Just joking. So, I first played that piece in, my goodness, I think I was like maybe 26 years old, and I'm 53 now, and I learn new things about it every time I play. You know, so I wouldn't be so obsessed about trying to figure out when to go to the next thing, because once you finish one thing and you may think that you've mastered it, you really haven't mastered it, because maybe you've mastered how to play it technically, but there's all kinds of things that you can find in your soul. There's also there are many other nuances that you can put in. Like, for instance, here's how the song goes that we're talking about. Let's get my mute out again. And so on. Now, I could play that 10 times and play it differently. The key is learning the blueprint of it and then finding out a way to make it your own. In the same way that I talked about the way that Ray Nance played the solo to Satin Doll, you know, he could have played the melody on the solo. But I think he did something like this. He made that his own. So learn the language and get as close as you can to what you're, to the person that you're transcribing. And even if you're not consciously thinking about it, that becomes a part of your DNA. It's the same thing like when you're in school and you learn vocabulary words in English class. You learn the definition of the word, but then you have to learn how to use that word in the context of a sentence. So I can know like a million vocabulary words, but if I don't know how to make those into a sentence, it doesn't really mean anything. So just learn as much as you can, and know that all the stuff that you put into your mind, into your soul, comes into a funnel, and what comes out of the funnel is going to be you. So just fill that funnel up and just keep learning. That's my best answer for that. Okay.
Thank you very much. Hope you're staying well. I'll talk to you soon.
Yes, sir. All right.
Thank you, Finn. All right, let's go to Jeffrey Ocampo. Jeffrey, you're on.
Hi, how are you doing, hey, Mr. Printup?
How are you, sir? Good to see you.
Good. I don't know if Mr. Rampton or Mr. Crenshaw is still here. How are you guys doing? I have a couple of questions, but I'll just my first question is, I find myself listening a lot, sometimes passively, sometimes actively, but sometimes I still feel confused on what do you listen for when you're listening to mostly big band tunes compared to combo tune.
Mm-hmm. Were you here for the entire lesson that we just did?
Yeah, I was here for the whole thing.
Yeah, so just the stuff that we talked about, just listen to it over and over. Well, okay, well, to be more specific about that, if you want to break it down, you have time now. There's a lot of time on our hands. So are you speaking specifically big band or just music
mostly
in general?
Mostly big band, because like, let's say the modulation that happened on Take the A-Train, I didn't really hear that compared to I listen to a lot more combo tunes. It's a lot easier for me to listen to things. There's just a lot more going on in big band tunes.
You know, it's really funny. I've seen, and I played these arrangements forever, and I think in the back of my head, I knew that there was a modulation, but until I studied this, these arrangements and broke them down like I did earlier, I was like, oh, that's how they do that. So that interlude, the first chord is a C. Then they go to B flat, which is a 5 of E flat. And it makes perfect sense. So, just things like that. But the great Dizzy Gillespie said, and I quote, "A prerequisite of learning jazz is learning the piano." So it's important that you go to the piano just to get familiar with the piano. And the more you play and the more that you know how to use it as a tool, I mean, I'm not saying learn how to play the piano and perform and sound like Dan Nimmer or Duke Ellington.
Yeah.
And if you want to do that too, but you got to really practice hard because Dan Nimmer's pretty darn good. But just learn how to use it as a tool. Learn how to, how to voice. For instance, do you play piano?
I do not. I play trumpet.
Okay, I'm going to give you something. Okay. Get a pencil out. You got a pencil?
Yeah.
All right. When you get to the piano, play a B-flat low in the bass.
Are we talking concert pitch or B-flat?
Concert pitch.
Okay.
Always concert pitch when I'm talking piano, concert pitch. Only trumpet pitch when I'm talking trumpet, clarinet, or tenor saxophone. Or baritone, whatever. All right, so low B flat, and then above that, an octave above that, play an A flat. What relation is the A flat to that B flat?
A fourth.
No. Okay. So.
Oh no! B-flat, my bad. That would be a seventh. Wouldn't it be a dominant seventh?
Dominant seven. There you go. So this is. I'm gonna give you like a really hip voicing. To voice a dominant seven chord, all right? So B flat, okay, we're in the key of B flat. So keep B flat bass up top, play A flat, then play a C. Now tell me what relation that C is to the B flat.
To the B flat, that would be a second?
Yeah, or a ninth.
So or ninth. A ninth.
There you go. So 7-9, and now the D would be what? Now then play a D, what would that be?
That would be the third or the...
There you go. The third.
Third.
Because everything in a chord depends upon the third. because if it's a B flat and a D, that's a major chord. If it's a B flat and a D flat, it's a minor chord or the start of a diminished chord or whatever. All right. Yeah. So you got 7, 9, 3, and then you're gonna play a G up top of that, which is the 6th or the 13th. So just remember 7, 9, 3, 6, and then play your root note in the bass. And learn how to play dominant sevenths based on that, and it's going to open your ears up to a lot of things.
Thank you.
That's just one kind of side note. This is kind of away from the question, but you know, but we're talking about music and jazz, and it's there are notes. It's all good. So, I mean, again, listen to a fresh arrangement, and just do what I did, and just okay. This is, you know, the saxes are playing the melody. Who's playing the lead line? Oh, the Barry sax player is playing the melody. Usually, the Barry sax is on the bottom of the band, and even when Harry Carney played the melody in the first take that we listened to, he was still on the bottom of the band, but he was playing the melody, but not like a supported like harmony part. And, you know, the last A section of the first arrangement, you know, the saxes went back to, you know, Hodges on lead alto playing the top voice. So, you know, just subtle things like that. And, you know, you just have to listen. And, you know, and again, you have plenty of time to do that.
Yeah, thank you.
I'm going to give you a challenge. Let's see. Something for you to listen to. I mean, I love Duke Ellington. Let's take another Duke Ellington tune. Okay, there's a beautiful ballad. It's called Isfahan. 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 Find that tune and break that down. And, you know, it's a beautiful ballad. One of the most beautiful ballads ever written. Thank you. Isfahan. Thank you, Chloe.
Yeah, thank
Check
you.
That out and just analyze it. All right.
Thank you. Right. One quick question. So I saw you use this plunger, right?
Mm-hmm.
But these are discontinued. You were using this plunger earlier in the video, but these are discontinued. What is like a second option you would use so I could get he's not that. I know. I was kind of sad because he left the chat. I know he's the person to ask.
Yeah, Kenny made some. He made some good music. I have my mute collection up here on the wall. But let's see if I can. I think my other mutes are downstairs. Let's see if I have. I just got this regular plunger mute right here.
Uh huh.
But there's one that Todd stole. Laid on to the trumpet section. It's downstairs, and I can't leave.
Yeah, that's fine.
Get it. But yeah, but just reach out to Kenny.
I know, because I know he was producing some, but I don't know if they were out yet.
Okay. They're not out quite yet. You know, like now's the time.
Of course, yeah, I know.
It's a difficult time. Yeah, but you know, but I would reach out to him, like maybe after all this slows down. You know.
Okay.
Awesome. Let's move on to another question. Thank you, Jeffrey. Thank you. All right, we're going to move on to Ezekiel. Go ahead, Ezekiel.
Hi.
You
Thank
have a question you. For?
Yeah.
Thank you, baby.
So, I missed something while you were talking about structure.
Okay, why was I talking about what now?
Structure. Of the
melody.
You said? Yeah. 2A, 1B, and 1.
Yeah, so basically it's called AABA. The first A section, I'm not sure Chloe, can they look at this broadcast again after it's taken down?
It'll be put on YouTube at some point in the future, but
okay. Yeah, it's okay. Yeah. I mean, you know, it's just basically the AABA is just one form. There are some forms that have different, like, some songs that have different forms. Let's think of Mary had a little lamb. That's just one thing. I'm trying to think of a regular song that has form, but, well, okay. So if I'm singing Take the A Train, that's A. Now you go back to the beginning again. So those are the same thing. So that's AA. Now B is different. That's B. Now you go back to the A and play the same thing that you played in the beginning. So that's A-A-B-A. Now what jazz musicians do is, you know, we play, well, you know, for the most part, especially in small group bands, we play the A-A-B-A, the melody, and then we repeat that section, those the A-A-B-A over and over, and we improvise on that. Ooh, someone's jamming. And we improvise on that form. So we improvise on the A-A-B-A form. You know, the blues is just like a 12-bar blues. If it's, there are many different kind of blues, but standard blues is just 12 bars. So we just play that 12 bars, maybe play the melody once or twice, and then we improvise on that form of the blues. And that form is just blues. It's an A form, 12 bars. So, you know, everything has form, you know? I mean, and playing jazz and classical music as well, you can deviate from that form and create something fresh and something different that also still fits. Yeah. Make sense?
Yeah, but my question was about last E.
Ezekiel, we actually have to move on. I'm sorry, we're running out of time, but thank you. Thank you for watching. All right, we can take one more question, but before we do, I just wanna say that we'll be hosting some more free live events for the coming weeks. More masterclasses, more conversations. We have a Q&A session with Wynton on Monday nights, tonight at 9 p.m. Eastern time, Skane's Domain. Our next JLCO masterclass will actually be on Wednesday, and that's with Kenny Rampton. Kenny will teach us about trumpet mutes, and we'll show you best practices and give you tips on how to play with the mute. So that will be, that will be Friday, April 17th at this time, on Facebook. I'll check back about that time, actually. It'll either be Wednesday or Friday. For a full list of upcoming events and archive concerts, you can check out our website, jazz.org. And again, thank you so much for everyone for being part of the community. If it's within your means, please consider making a donation. Jazz Lincoln Center is a nonprofit organization. We're committed to entertaining, enriching, and expanding a global community for jazz. We're extraordinarily grateful for your contributions of any amount. And to our supporters and donors, we can't thank you enough. So let's take our final question from Luther Winter.
Hey, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Oh, yes, great. Sir. Hey, Marcus.
How you doing, sir?
Your former neighbor at 409.
Oh, dude, hey, good to see you. I remember you.
Regards to
I missed the hood.
Regards
I missed the hood, man.
As well, man.
Yes, sir.
I missed the first piece, the first half, and I'm not a musician. And anyway, regards form, right, and soloing over the form, right? How are you able to keep a track of where you are in the song, the melody? Okay.
Yeah.
Once you go all the way through once, that's one chorus, I'm thinking, right? How do you know, is it the chords or are you counting?
We're more so feeling now, you know. I mean, you know, when you get to even when you're just starting, you know, most of the young musicians have, you know, the music in front of them, and they're reading, you know, the form, and okay, there will be repeat dots at the very beginning of the form and at the end. So let's say it's like a 12 bar form, you know, a blues. You play that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, then repeat as you go back to the top, and just keeps going on and on. And it's just a matter of feeling it. It's just something that we do for our essentially Ellington High School band competition. I've been to all 25. Well, this is the 25th year, and I think the bands that play the best are the ones that actually memorize their music. I'm talking about it, you know, entire scores of music. They'll turn their stands around or just walk on the stage without music. And I think when you don't have the music in front of you, you actually feel it more. when people transcribe solos, some people read them and write them out, which is cool because it's good to know how to notate and it's good to know how to read music. But I think in my experience in learning transcribed solos, for instance, if I want to learn a Clifford Brown solo, the great Clifford Brown, if I read it, I'm relying upon my sight as opposed to my ears. So when I play music, I don't want to play it like I'm reading it. I want to play it like I'm hearing it and I'm feeling it from my heart. So that being said, the more we listen to these arrangements and the more we listen to form, it just kind of happens naturally. And even if you don't realize it, you probably hear form too, you know, in everything you do. I mean, what is your occupation, if you don't mind me asking?
I used to be an administrator, just a HR, human resources, yeah.
I bet that there are so many things that may be routine to you that if I were to see it, I would say, okay, man, I give up. I can't do this.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It's just a thing like that, you know? So, if you get a chance to listen to the first part of this lesson or to anything that we, you know, I'm not the only one that's taught this, but, you know, there's a way to listen to music and to go deeper inside of what the music is. And I will give you this. Have you heard the jazz record by Miles Davis called Kind of Blue?
Of course, yes.
Yeah, yes, sir. So listen to each track on that record separately. Like I think the first track is, what's the first track? So What? Uh-huh. So listen to it like six times in a row.
Yes.
The first time, only focus, who's writing this stupid shit online? That's crazy. Come on, man.
Sorry, we're getting hacked. We should probably end this soon because I'm losing control. Sorry, everyone. Okay. That's clearly not me.
People are so stupid. You know, we're gonna ignore them because they don't matter to us. So I'm gonna finish what I'm saying to you. So listen to it like six times in a row. And the first time, only focus on Paul Chambers on the bass. Just only listen to him. Only focus on him. Okay. Then the second time, only focus on Wynton Kelly or Bill Evans, because there's two pianists on the record. And then the third time, only check out Jimmy Cobb. Then on the fourth time, only check out Miles. Fifth time, only check out what Cannonball is playing. And the sixth time, only check out what Coltrane is playing. Yeah. And you'll hear things that you never heard before. And that's how we hear form, you know.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. All right, man. Good to see
you. Thank you. Take care.
All right.
All right, everyone. That's all we have time for today. Sorry again about all the hacking and Zoom bombing and all that. We try to get on top of all the security aspects of Zoom, you know.
And I do want to say, one quick thing.
Yeah,
everyone.
Go ahead.
If you haven't seen Wynton's spot on 60 Minutes last night, please see it. I taught some lessons. I actually teach at Montclair State University, and I had two lessons this morning, and one of my students was talking about the fact that he feels that his senior year has been ruined because of this, and you know he's not motivated to practice and this and that. So I actually played Wynton's video of a Wynton spot on 60 Minutes, and it really picked him up because Wynton's father just passed away a few weeks ago. And I'll tell you, man, you know, this man is like calling us in the band. You know, this is inside information, but it's nothing deep. We have Zoom meetings every week amongst, you know, the band members, you know, just to check on each other, just to make sure that we're still being productive and we're still doing projects and we're still working. I mean, Wynton's father just passed away and he's still on it. So if you get down, if you get depressed, that's normal, but try to pick yourself up because this is the time to where we have to rise above all the adversity, because if we stay down, we're going to be down. So let's fight this. And let's get through it together. All right.
That's awesome. Yeah, that piece is really special. I second that. We miss our hall over at in Columbus Circle in New York City. So it was great to see it as well in the story. Clearly, I'm missing it because pretending I'm there now. all right, everyone. Thank you again for joining us. I'm going to leave the chat open just for another minute, awesome. Just so people can share their remarks and say what they need to say and ask any questions. People are asking about the Miles Davis piece that you shared. It was just Kind of Blue, right? Kind of Blue that you suggested.
Yeah, well, the name of the CD is Kind of Blue, but the song that I was singing is called So What.
Yeah, So What.
That's the first song. But you know, listen to everything on the CD. I mean, everything on the CD. And someone was asking the name of that. Or were they asking The name of the Wynton? The Wynton 60 Minutes thing. Just Google Wynton Marsalis 60 Minutes and put in the date. I have no idea what day it was yesterday. Is it the 12th? Is it?
I don't know. Yeah, the 12th, from April 12th.
Yeah.
All right, everyone. Yeah. Really appreciate you being a part of this. Again, we're here 5 days a week with classes, and check us out, jazz.org, on all social media, or search Jazz Lincoln Center on Facebook. Take care, everyone. Thank you, Marcus. Marcus, play us out. Bye, everyone. Thank you.
Hey, Adrian.